And welcome back to episode 8 of Matter Of Fax. I am your co-host, Alec Cranston of Cushman & Wakefield, here with my esteemed co-host, James Collins, also of Cushman & Wakefield. We are delighted to be back for our 8th episode. Time is flying by, eh?
Isn't it? We'll be having the 12-month Matter Of Fax birthday before we know it.
Oh, yeah. I can't wait. That's going to be a big
episode. How are we
going
to celebrate?
That's going to be a big one. That's
skywriting, banners off the McDonald Bridge. We'll figure it out.
The one that you painted, or did you paint the McKay? I forget your
name. No, I did the McDonald. But this is, it's going to be big budget. I think we'll spend at least $15 on the 1-year birthday.
Oh, no problem at all. No, that's just for the Timmy's Donuts and a few coffees.
Exactly.
Very good. No, we're very excited. Today's episode, we have our regular segment, Insane as the Crane. We're going to talk about something that everyone was talking about for about a week there, and I'm sure you can all relate. And then we have a guest with us today, Jonathan Lander, the Redhead Realtor, to talk to us about the current real estate market from a residential perspective, kind of how things are going for him and what he's seeing out there, any trends. And we'll talk a bit about his branding as well. And then we have our new kids on the block, which isn't so much new kids, but a current kid out there with
an adolescent kid.
Adolescent kid, perfect. With new location. They're a great spot. We'll get more on that later. And then the Reddit Roundup, I did plant a post for the Reddit Roundup. It got a little bit of action, decent amount of action. And I got a couple other Reddit posts I found as well I'd like to talk about. And then we'll wrap things up for the, I think this would technically be the second last episode of 2022.
It would. We're getting very seasonal now. You know, Remembrance Day happens and all the stores go, okay, it's now acceptable to fill the shelves with sparkly overpriced Christmas things. The next episode, we're just going to put a little teaser out there for the next episode. Well, how do we introduce this one? We just want to keep you engaged. We are going to be bringing on wives and girlfriends.
Yes.
We're going to come into the studio pretty late after a couple of adult drinks.
Cocktails.
And see what happens.
I'm looking forward to that. It's a different kind of vibe. I mean, for that episode, I'm looking forward to doing an episode in the dark. We already are. It's dark right now. But I'm excited for that. I know Jenna's on board already. I think it's going to be a good time.
Oh, Jen's on board. Just put up with a boring episode this month and we'll get to the fun stuff
exactly.
Next.
Exactly. And you know what? Maybe after the podcast, next one, things might continue on afterwards. Who knows? It might be a full night affair. We shall see. And there might be a little doggo involved as well.
A little Tucker, my little dog. He's going to come here. We'll bring him on.
He'll come.
He's
good. Yeah.
He won't need a microphone.
No, he doesn't need a mic? Okay, we'll have him in the middle of the table, though. He just needs
a lap.
Perfect. All right, let's jump right into it, James, and the Insane as the Crane.
Insane as the Crane. Insane as the Crane. Insane is the crane.
Kind of insane like the crane.
Insane is the crane.
All right, here we go.
Insane.
The 8th insane thing that we have featured on this podcast. So this is talking about we lost Theodore 2 last year, unfortunately, but we did have a new addition to, isn't it bad? I was just thinking the other day how we should have got together and pulled our money and bought Theodore and started an Airbnb.
There was a push for I saw on Twitter pushes for like Nathan McKinnon or like Brad Marchand or Sidney Crosby to buy Theodore 2, because that would have been they probably had that money in their pocket that they could have bought it. But no one bit. Anyways, enough about Theodore 2. I'll get emotional if we talk about Theodore 2.
Me too. And there is always the benefit to a little tug. And I think we should have invested in Theodore. But
I completely agree.
So this month we are talking about the USS Gerald Ford, which rolled on into the Halifax Harbour at the end of October. It's touted as the US Navy's newest and most advanced aircraft carrier. And it came here as part of its maiden deployment. It's huge. This thing's 100,000 tons. It's considered the world's largest aircraft carrier. And it was taking part in some naval exercises with a number of NATO allies, including Canada, Spain, Denmark, Netherlands, and Germany. NATO is on everybody's mind right now with some unfortunate geopolitical events taking place. So while here, it came on into the harbor. It took part in some scheduled events. I must say, the sailors on board took part in scheduled events, not the aircraft carrier itself. The sailors volunteered at a thrift store, not the aircraft carrier, because it wouldn't have fitted into the grocery store. Mm-hmm. They volunteered at a food bank, an animal shelter, Habitat for Humanity. There was also a reception for some Halifax community leaders and foreign dignitaries. So
very cool.
Did you go and take a look at it?
I'm going to be completely honest. I didn't. And I told myself.
Nor did I.
Oh, you didn't either? Wow. Look at us. I thought I was the only one. I saw it was riddled on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook. It was everywhere. And every day it got posted, I was like, oh, it must be gone by now. Every time I saw it, I was like, oh, I must have missed it. I must have missed it. And the next day would come, and there was another post about it. I was like, oh, it's still there. I guess I can go see it. And then day by day went by until eventually it left. And I never did go see it. I saw enough photos and videos, but I do sort of regret not seeing it, because I guess it was quite the spectacle to see it comparable to the island and how it shaped up. It was pretty cool. It's just I always love when something like that comes to
people lost their shit.
They lost
online.
Their minds, man. It was like, it was everywhere. It was like such a big deal. And then the news guys were tweeting about it every single day, as if it the posts I saw on social media were as if it like had just got there each day. Like it was as if no one had seen it yet. But it was very cool. It was cool seeing all the fighter jets and on there in the photos. I wish I would have came down and saw it. That's my regret, is not seeing it in person. But I do think it's really cool when something like that comes to Halifax. And I don't know, it also shows, you know, our, what's the word I'm looking for? As a port type city, as a city that can
prevalence and relevance,
something like that can handle something like that. That's pretty cool. And that, so I found that very interesting. I saw some funny posts on Reddit and Twitter saying, like, of course, the skeptics and the conspiracy theorists that thinking like, oh, this is here for a reason.
They're laying underground cables.
Yep, something's happening. Like, we are about to be... I saw one person post on Twitter, we're going to be under attack. They're just not telling
us. But I would... If I was going to be under attack, I'd want it when the world's biggest aircraft carrier was
in
the port.
It's like
an ambulance. I once said to my mother, I saw an ambulance scream past me as a kid, and I said, isn't it sad that somebody right now needs an ambulance? And my mother said, no, isn't it great that someone's getting wonderful care?
That's true. It's right? A good way of thinking. It's a positive way of thinking about a negative situation. So
they probably died, though.
Yeah, most likely. Maybe. That's tough. But if we, you know, I lost my train of thought from that one. Sorry. It's all good. But, you know, you're right. If we're under attack, it's nice to know. If I'm not a conspiracy theorist. I did not think that.
Like, it's either me running down to the Bedford Basin with a shovel, or it's the world's biggest aircraft carrier.
I trust that.
In the harbor.
I heard you're pretty good with a shovel. You're pretty good at shoving, I think.
Very good with a shovel.
Yeah.
In more ways than one.
I've heard
the untold story of the USS Gerald Ford is the thousands of sailors who arrived in Halifax and fired up their Tinder profiles with their location-specific geo-targeting.
Oh, yeah? So you saw them on there?
Oh, that's a burn. No, I saw them on Bumble. I think Bumble's just women, right?
No, the woman has to message first.
Okay, so that proves I don't have either. Yeah. But
good.
Apparently all the sailors came onto shore, fired up Tinder, and everybody's Tinder profiles in HRM went, there's like 2,500 new people.
Mm-hmm.
So a night of activity.
Wow. Interesting. Very cool.
Do you want to hear some facts I found about the USS Gerald Ford?
Yes, please. Please.
Okay. The carrier has a complement, which is seamen speak for how many people are on it. The carrier has a complement of 4,500 sailors and 75 aircraft.
Yo.
So lots of seamen.
Yes, tons.
It costs $13.3 billion to build.
Really?
To Elon Musk, a couple of bucks.
Exactly.
She was formally commissioned by President Donald Trump on 22nd of July, 2017. Now, rumor has it the U.S. Navy will soon be announcing the commissioning of the USS Donald Trump. This is a joke I wrote. I'm just going to preface this because it's utter shit. The Navy will soon be announcing the commissioning of the USS Donald Trump, which will be painted orange, will contain a vault with 6-foot-thick concrete to hide his tax returns, and will have a foghorn that sounds like a crying baby.
Wow. Wow. Very good. And the wig, and the floating wig.
They're just putting thousands of tons of straw.
Yes, hay, yeah. Straw, whatever it takes.
Next fact is the USS Gerald Ford is equipped with 2 nuclear reactors and its own electrical generating plant.
Oh, wow.
And the final fact is Alec Cranston took one look at it and thought it was the Blue Nose.
That's... I gotta admit, I thought it was the Tall Ship Silva or the Harbor Queen, one of the two. No, that's a good Insane as the Crane. I like that one. Everyone knows, has seen the ship. A lot of semen on board, though. Wow, that's incredible.
Too much. And I heard from the U.S. Navy that they weren't bringing it into Halifax until they heard about this podcast.
Yeah, that's what I heard, too.
They said...
That's crazy.
If we bring it in, maybe they'll feature us.
They might talk about us. They're going to talk about us once we're long gone, but they will talk about us. So I think Dylan, who is not here today, we don't know why.
He's just basic slacking off.
Probably, I don't know, 3-hour photo shoot or something. But he's gone, so I don't know where he could be. But he might do some. I see some artwork in our future involving that ship. So I'm looking forward to seeing what he drums up there, because he's a wizard with Adobe Illustrator.
He's good.
Yeah,
we miss Dylan. I feel a void in the podcast today.
In the corner over there. Yeah. That's his chair. We left it open.
No one can see this at home, but there is this studio. It has a naughty stool in the corner, yeah. where the bad boy sits, and that's typically Dylan.
James has one at home. Anyway, so
while Dylan's not here because it's dark and he can't see the butterflies out of the window.
Sorry, Dylan, you're not here to defend yourself. It's okay,
though.
Isn't
it better when people can't defend themselves?
It's great because you can just keep going.
Well, people always say, don't talk about them that way. They're not here to defend themselves. I'm like, the whole reason I want
to
do it.
Yeah, it's like they could have been here. They could have chose to be here. They chose not to be. So we can roast them. Anyways, Insane as the Crane, the SS Gerald, what was it? No.
The SS? Well, it's not a 100-year-old steamship. It was like, it is the USS Gerald Ford, the US Gerald Ford.
Anyway, that's a good one. That was a great one, James. That was your idea, actually. That was great. My Insane as the Crane idea was not nearly as good. Mine
what was it?
It was talking about these two women went to a local pub, $395 bill in the span of only a few hours, I think, and then just up and left. Like, that's bad, first of all.
Pretty good pictures of them, though.
Yeah, they got them right on the CCTV, right? But $395, and this is a bar. I won't name the bar. I don't want to do any of that. This is a bar that, let's just say, every day, every hour is happy hour. I don't even know why they advertise it as we have happy hour, because it's always on deals. So
happy days. Sunday, happy Monday, happy days. Tuesday, Wednesday, happy days. Thursday, Friday, happy days. Saturday, what a day. Spending all week with you. Isn't that the lyrics? Do you remember that? My mother used to know. She was.
My mom will get that, not me. I think whatever you just did there. I don't know.
Remember happy days?
Never watched that. Is that a show? No, my mom will get that, and she's going to make fun of me for not understanding
it. Alec, you're missing out.
I know. Next time.
Have you heard of the Backstreet Boys?
Oh, my gosh, yes. First concert I ever went to.
Oh, actually, the Backstreet Boys.
Backstreet's back. All right. Yes.
R.I.P. Aaron Carter.
Oh, yes. Rest in peace. Yeah, I love the Backstreet Boys. Went to their concert. I am a huge fan.
Oh, so hang on. You did go to the concert?
Yes.
Toronto?
No, Halifax. They were here.
When?
Oh, a long time ago. Oh, I don't know. I would have been in elementary school.
Oh, so you're talking about original Backstreet Boys, not these reunion tours?
No, like I was OG Backstreet Boys. Huge
fan.
Wow. I still listen to some of their. I have a playlist, Best of Backstreet.
Do not be ashamed. My entire playlist is late 90s pop.
No, that's no problem.
British bands like S Club 7, not very famous over here. These people, it is gym music. It is amazing.
Oh, yeah, when you're pumping in the gym?
Oh, pumping all the time.
Very good, very good. Well, that was Insane as the Crane. Up next, we have our guest. He is just in the studio now, waiting to come in.
I can see him.
I can see him
graciously
now.
Coming in.
I can
in.
See the red hair. Redhead Realtor, Jonathan Lander, will be in momentarily. Stay tuned. All right, and we are here with our guest, Jonathan Lander, also known as the Redhead Realtor, a realtor with RE/MAX Nova. Jonathan, welcome onto the podcast. We're going to have a good conversation just about the market in general, where things are going, where it's been, what it's like out there for buyers and sellers and agents alike. I mean, James and I are commercial real estate agents, so we see a bit of a different side of it, but we do get tastes of the residential world. So we're looking forward to hearing it from somebody's perspective who does it day in and day out.
I think everyone thinks they're an expert on the housing market as well.
Oh, definitely.
So it's one of those topics when you're at a family party or in a social setting, everyone's like, so the housing market, what do you think? And most people are armchair experts. So we figured let's get straight from the expert and we'll bring you on and grill you a bit. I think, Alec, you want to kick this one off. Firstly, welcome. As the sun sets over Halifax, just to let people know we're recording this early evening. And previously when we've been here, we've been in the right time of year that it's stays beautifully light, but I kind of like the romantic setting out there.
I like the ambiance kind of coming down here.
If you're going to interact with a realtor, it's nice to have some romance.
I like it. I agree. But before we get going, we have some cold items in front of us here of the can variety, and you have something you want to say right quickly about those. We're going to indulge in them, but you got a little bit.
We're going to talk about North Brewing a little later in the podcast, but we have got some North Brewing products in front of us. We've got two, the Pleasant Disposition IPA and the Staple Malternate Reality New England IPA. So we're going to crack one and have a great conversation. So choose a brew, gentlemen.
All right.
Because it's a podcast and our listeners need to get a feel of the ambience, you are required to open them directly next to your microphone. Have a sip.
Alternate reality.
What have we got? I've got the pleasant disposition.
Oh. And you know I got to do that first sip.
Oh, we have a can malfunction.
Going for round two.
Ooh.
Oh, yeah.
Ooh, that's got a little kick to it. Mmm.
Let's go in here.
Get in there.
Craft beer is good.
Mm.
Never get a bad beer with these guys.
No, they're great.
But we'll chat about North Brewing a little bit later on. We're going to be featuring them. So let's talk real estate, something Alec and I typically do on the other side of the fence, not the residential side, but let's chat residential.
Oh, we love talking about it. So, I mean, I'm going to start off by just asking the typical question. Just how, like, what's it like out there right now for you as a residential agent with the housing market kind of fluctuating up and down? I feel like we hear different things every day. I guess that's a very broad question, but just like, what are you kind of experiencing right now? And what are some trends you're starting to see and kind of outlooks going into the start of 2023 here?
Mm. Yeah, I think the big thing so far that I've seen, especially over the past month or two with the rates going up the way they have, you got to manage expectations. I think that's the big thing, both on the buy and sell side. I mean, you rewind, you know, I got into real estate just over a year ago, right? So I can't sit here and say, you know, I know what it was like 5 years ago with a still market and so on and so forth. But with my experience in here, I've seen that, you know, 6 months ago, you know, you do a good job of the listing side of it. And you're going to have, I think my first open house, I counted 42 heads through the front door. Oh. Not normal. Not
really.
Like, it's just, yeah. And that's, so it's it was very, very competitive. I mean, rates were so low, not that money is ever free, but from a lending perspective,
yeah,
money was so free. And I think on outside of that as well, a lot of people forget the lower the rate, usually the higher your pre-approval can be,
mm-hmm,
based off of a lending perspective, at least from a residential side.
Right.
It mimics it in the commercial world too.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so
there's,
exactly.
There's other dynamics like income on the property and mm-hmm everything else, but similar dynamic.
Right. So getting a pre-approval a year ago was easy as can be.
Yeah.
On average, right?
Yeah.
Obviously, there's, you know, external factors. So I think now what we're starting to see as rates go up, you know, unfortunately, a lot of buyers are unable to get pre-approved for an amount they'd like,
yep,
and or they just can't afford it, unfortunately. And then outside of that, with less buyers comes less competition. Sellers still having that expectation of 6 months ago,
mm-hmm,
you know, not in all cases, but on average, that's what I see. And so you are seeing homes sit for a little longer. Those price drops. I mean, I think something really interesting to point out that, you know, was one of the biggest questions to me with all my friends asking is, why are we seeing homes be listed at six and then 2 weeks later be listed at 650? Why are they going up in price?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, just from my experience seeing that, I think the reason behind that was what they wanted to do was list a little bit lower to have that bidding war that we saw 6 months ago. But unfortunately, they missed that peak.
Right.
There's not as many buyers, as many bidding wars, again, on average.
Right.
So what they had to do is adjust their price to more of what they were actually willing to sell their home for to kind of manage that, what they wanted to see.
Yeah, that one of my questions was going to be about bidding wars and just like if that's something that was still, you were seeing a lot of bidding wars or houses like you just said, being priced more true to what they are. And is that because of also, you know, comparables in the area, houses that have sold for a high price in an area, like say multiple houses, an agent goes to price up the house, pending a value, you know, they can't lowball it so out of the question because mm-hmm it's just not going to work. I don't know. So yeah, that was, I mean, from somebody, a perspective of somebody here who is hoping to buy a home in the next 6 to 8 months, you know, I'm wondering if I'm going to be getting into a bidding war or is it more houses being priced true to what they should be going for?
I think overall, you're definitely starting to see the home prices be listed at what they're really hoping for. But outside of that, I mean, every house is different, right? I think location, you know, obviously that's all, and I'm sure you hear in commercial as well that, you know, location is huge, mm-hmm, but especially in residential. You know, there are still homes out there that are getting multiple offers. Absolutely there are.
Yeah.
But again, I know I used the word on average, but on average, you are seeing that there are just a lot less buyers, a lot less competition. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, you are seeing homes sit there. And, yeah, you know, you are seeing people get offers, but they're not getting what they want. So they're just like, I'm not selling it then.
Question I had for you, are sellers still operating as if it's 2020. Because what we had then was sellers that were listing for extremely high prices, getting into bidding wars, turning down offers they otherwise would have accepted, because back then essentially somebody else was waiting behind them, or if they weren't, would come along soon. With interest rates rising, are sellers accepting what the market's doing and moving on, or are they still trying to operate like they were a year and a half ago?
I think that's what it comes down to. When I first mentioned, you know, manage expectations, you know, when I go into a listing appointment now or what have you, you know, I think one of the main things is I give them a number based off of statistics. It's not anything to do with emotions or what have you. And that's, you know, kind of veering away from that question just in regards to commercial as a residential. You know, residential, there's a lot of emotion behind a sale. Mm-hmm. You know, my kids grew up here. I don't want to sell it for this. I put so much work and so much time and heart. Commercial, it's numbers. If the numbers don't work, then it doesn't work.
Yeah, and emotions in our world, Alec and I's, it's down to the idiosyncrasies of the individual. Yeah. You know, we deal with clients from the complete cross-section of humanity. Some people are naturally a little more volatile, a bit more emotional, but you're right. It's never really attached to the property. It's just that individual has to be the smartest guy with the biggest ego in the
world. Yeah, exactly. So yeah, I guess back to your question there, it's, you know, I think some sellers are certainly upset that they missed, you know, what we would say is the peak. But I think it comes down to just, you know, trying to manage their expectations and letting them know what it would list for based off of factors such as comparables, location, you know, so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. But you're definitely still seeing some sellers say, no, if you want this listing, you're going to list it at this price.
And it's okay to walk away, as Alec and I have learned. Sometimes when the expectation certainly is way off, you know that's a relationship that will go sour. And I always tell everybody, I only work with people I can bring success to and succeed with.
Yeah.
If I feel there's a misalignment of expectation, I'll walk away. But it's not because I don't want the business. It's just because I can't do what I want to do for that client.
Mm-hmm. It's better for both parties in the
end. It is better for both parties.
And that comes down to, I think, is just trust. And that's why, you know, kind of adding a little extra factor to that, I think that's why referrals, you know, especially in the residential world, I'm sure, again, in the commercial, but that's why referrals are so important, is because already there is that sense of trust. Mm-hmm. You know, hey, my sister-in-law referred you. You know, already you have some sort of a connection there. I like your sister-in-law, so chances are I'm going to align with you.
Right.
Right? When you go into a complete stranger's home, not to say that you won't have a fantastic go, but there are those moments where there's no trust, no connection. You don't know what you're walking into the second you get in that front door.
Mm-hmm. And the tough thing is, we will all agree in this room, and I mean this in the most respectful way I can to us and our brothers and sisters in the industry and our clients, when you work in real estate, for some reason, I know why, you are always in a position of distrust when you first meet someone.
Mm-hmm.
We exist in a world and in a profession where we have a leg down, so to speak, whenever we meet people. So I always talk about, if you're pitching advertising services or something, people know you're a salesman and you're trying to sell to them and you're trying to pitch. I always feel in the real estate world that we start even lower than that. And before we can start to build the typical relationship, we have to build so much more trust.
Yep.
And I've gone to over 8 years, I've gone to so many meetings where I walk in and people go, oh, hey, here's the greedy real estate guy.
Yeah, yeah.
And they want your services, and they are shopping around for a commercial broker, but you still get treated with that real estate. You get tarred with a real estate brush is probably the best way to put it.
Yeah.
And it could be tough, but this is the great thing in our industry, is that when you build that trust, like, that is a lifelong relationship. If you do a damn good job and do what you set out to do and you're honest, our industry is one where clients trust you with the deepest, most intimate parts of their financials, and for us, their business operations. It's great. I love that.
And just like you're saying with the referrals, the moment, you know, if you gain that trust from a client, then all of a sudden another client calls you because you were referred to them by that client, then you know you've gotten that level of trust.
That's exactly what I mean.
That's going to be hard to break. And, you know, James, you're totally right. Like, you step into a meeting sometimes and you feel like you have to convince them that you have their best interests at heart. They immediately think it's all, we just want to get paid and move on. I've had agents say that to me before, like, oh, you're a commercial agent, you just want to get paid, it's all you care about. I was like, no, I want to make sure the deal gets done right for my client. And if it's not going to work, then we're just going to go somewhere else.
I had it today. Someone said to me, are you suggesting that landlord because they'll pay you more? And I said, No, they'll pay me an industry standard rate. I'm stressing that, landlord, because you'll have the best experience you can have from a Halifax office management and tenant satisfaction perspective. So,
because it benefits us long term. If you, because you know, if you rush to get a deal done, and whether it's a sale of a home or a commercial lease, if you rush to get a deal done, then it might seem great off the hop. The deal's done. Boom! Wow, we got a space so quick. You get paid. You move on. But as time goes along, your clients can realize, oh, this isn't really probably the best option for me. This isn't working out the way I thought it was going to be. But if we take our time and truly have their best interests at heart and, you know, think about that end goal, think about their satisfaction, in the long run, it's going to play off so much better for their trust that they're going to have in us, and then the referrals, and then the future business. And I think that's something we all have to kind of realize. And I think everyone in this room does. And, you know, there's lots that need to work on that.
Well, and people will see right through that.
I'm good. Sorry, guys. People listening, I just had a gas attack from the beer I was drinking.
Oh, jeez.
A mouth gas attack, I must say.
Oh.
I try to hide it from the mic, but no, we're good. Continue.
Fair.
Can I ask a question about first-time buyers?
Yeah, absolutely.
Correct me if I'm wrong here. I have not been a first-time buyer for 10 years. You can only be a first-time buyer once. At one point, I was. And we were in a very stable market. We were in Ontario at the time, and money was very cheap, and we knew that we needed our 20% down payment, and we spent years saving, and we knew when we got there, we would be in a position to buy. Am I correct in thinking that over the last couple of years, with house prices, those guys that were planning over the next 3 years to save their 20% to avoid CMHC insurance are seeing the property prices boom and then find that their ability to buy a home is stifled and that they have to save for a down payment twice as big as what they were thinking unless they take the, you know, put out 5% and swallow the insurance? The short question is, how did the pandemic affect first-time buyers that were in a steady plan to save for a down payment to buy a home, then finding the prices going crazy?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, there's no hiding it. It has been, and it's going to be a little bit tougher. I think a huge factor, though, that plays into that is the media. I think every media headline you read is a negative one, you know, because they know that's what's going to sell. From a media head point, they want their articles to sell, and they know that if they say housing prices for Nova Scotians, especially first-time home buyers, will never be achievable, well, they're wrong. I mean, in just 1 year of business, you know, I've helped a handful of first-time home buyers of all ages, obviously, but you know, even young people, right? It all comes down to certain factors. I mean, there are some incentives. Obviously, if you can avoid the incentives, you know, why not? But there are things out there to assist. First-time home buyer incentive in Nova Scotia. I believe it's the Nova Scotia Down Payment Assistance Program.
Is that the old home buyers plan?
I think so.
So you can draw from the RSP.
And pay back over.
And
there's other factors. You know, I mean, I think, you know, I can't speak to everybody, but I would say a majority of first-time home buyers is the 5%, which is certainly a lot more achievable for most people. But I think, yeah, I think what it comes down to is the media is putting such a negative portrayal in people's minds where they're defeated before they even talk to a financial advisor, before they even talk to a mortgage broker or whatnot. They're just like, it's not worth it. I can't do it.
I find it's hard to talk about buying a home in front of the general public. You talk to anyone in conversation and, you know, someone says, oh, what's going on? Like, oh, where are you living? Like, yeah, but we're looking to buy a home. I mean, Jen and I are looking to buy a home next year. So we've had this conversation with many, many, many people. And it's always like, oh, you're choosing now to do it? Or like, oh, not with this market. It's like, well, if you're paying attention to what's going on and, you know, yes, it's been bad, but it is getting a bit better. And if you plan the way we have, then it's going to work out. But everyone just immediately goes to that negative mindset. And you're right. I think it's because of the media. They're just like, oh, market, buying a home? Wow, you're crazy. Why would you ever do that?
Well, you go.
You're our guest. I insist that you go ahead.
I was just going to say, though, I mean, I keep saying on average, but overall, you know, where are they getting that negative approach because of what they're reading in the headlines? They didn't just buy a home. They didn't just get screwed over.
Yeah, they weren't in the...
All the armchair experts.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Tell people you're going to invest in something. The person who's never bought an investment in their life will give you their opinion.
Well, that's what I think it all comes back to, you know, about 10 or so when I talked about trust. You know, that's why it is so important. Don't work with a realtor or whatnot because it's your second uncle twice removed cousin.
Mm-hmm.
Work with someone you trust. That way when they give you advice, you have that, okay, you know, I'm glad they gave me that. Even if you're not comfortable and you don't want to go ahead with it, that's okay. But don't work with someone that you're going to say, You know, Jonathan told me this, but I just, he's wrong. Again, I just don't think it. And then next thing you know, when you see on Viewpoint or wherever website you check all the time that it sold for the price that was recommended. Mm-hmm. You know what? If you don't want to go ahead with it, that's fine. But I think trust is the big thing with that.
That line you said is pretty funny. I feel like as commercial agents, we hear all the time, oh, my agent told me this, but he's wrong, so I'm not going to listen to him.
Well, the other one I love is, what do you think, if a property's for sale, what do you think they'll take for it? I always joke and say, they'll take full price.
Yeah.
Absolutely,
yeah,
all day long.
Or if they ask you and say, well, what's the lowest your client will go? What's the listing price? 600? He'll take 600. Higher would be better, but he'll take 600.
Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah, and I think the other point that people need to remember is, and this applies to the residential and the commercial world, it also applies to the stock market and many other things, real estate is cyclical. So yeah. Come back to Alec's point. Oh, you don't want to buy now, as the naysayers will tell you. Mm-hmm. Well, what are you going to do? Hold off and pay rent for another 7 years till interest rates are historically low? No. Mm-hmm. If you get a variable rate mortgage, and correct me if I'm wrong here, you get a variable rate mortgage now, you will tether and be bungee corded to those interest rates when they go down, mm-hmm. and at least you're building equity and not paying the landlord. So I mm-hmm. think you're always going to have people tell you not to do something, but real estate is cyclical. I would argue our industrial lease market isn't, for reasons I won't go into in this podcast, but the majority of real estate is, mm-hmm. and you just have to, you just have to get in. It's like index funds.
Yeah.
Right? You know, over time, you're going to make money. Get in.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the best time to buy was 10 years ago. Mm. And I mean, 20 years ago, 30 years ago. And 10 years from now, when new people are doing another podcast and they're talking about all it, they're going to say, damn, you know, the best time to buy was 10 years ago.
Yeah.
Right? Long term, real estate is a long term investment. It always has been. So I think, you know, my broker, he made a really good point. He said, all you guys that got in over the past 2 years, that's great. Forget it. That's not normal.
Yeah.
That is not a normal market. And you ask any agent, I'm even sure with commercial, that's not supposed to happen. What just happened in the past year?
Right.
And
no,
half. Like
no,
that's
you're right.
That's not. And that's the thing, you know, kind of getting back to your point where it's, you know, the greedy real estate agent. No one wants that. Mm-hmm. You know, they think we do because they go home. You know, a lot of people watch Sell and Sunset and they think that's what real estate is.
Oh, man.
Oh, my God. No,
there is one right now I like right now, buying Beverly Hills. Anyway, keep going.
But no one wants that market. Like, you know, there was agents. You had to submit 20 offers for your clients before you got an accepted offer. No one wants that.
Well, yeah. I spoke to, I won't name him, but I spoke to a very good friend who's a residential realtor probably 6 months into the pandemic. And he's like, across my clients, I'm about 150 offers in to every accepted offer. So his clients turn around and say, you're getting paid too much because the home is overpriced. But he's like, you understand, I'm 150 hours of work in to get paid.
I love this current market right now. I mean, you know, during the pandemic, there was no negotiations for the most part. It was, here's our offer with no conditions at all. Oh, and your roof needs to get fixed. Oh, buyers will take it. We'll because that's just what it was. And like, tell me how that's right. You know, that's not. I mean, negotiating's fun. You know, I negotiated a broken tractor. With a deal, I don't know if that's okay.
No, it's always something like that. Like that's.
But
the fun
that's part. Mattress talks on this podcast mattress. Before. We've got some mattress stories. So you beat us there. Alec and I have both done deals where they've tried to include dusty mattresses.
Yeah.
I think you've just trumped us.
Broken tractor.
Broken tractor. Yeah.
Takes the cake
on
those.
That currently holds the Matter of Fax podcast award for the strangest thing negotiated in a deal.
Yeah, a broken tractor.
Please email us at halifaxpodcast@gmail.com if you can if you can beat that out of the deal.
Yeah, I would love to hear that. The next Reddit post will do that.
Yeah, but no, I think the way it's going right now, and that's the tricky thing. I mean, again, with the media, you're hearing that it's impossible for buyers. But I think right now, you know, and take the real estate out of it, right now is a perfect time. Like, you know, my girlfriend and I, we're looking at getting into an investment mm-hmm. here. And over the winter is an amazing time for buyers. No one wants to buy, like no one, you know, really wants to buy over the winter, Christmas, it's cold.
Yeah.
Take advantage of that. Less competition yet again, right? The less competition, the better.
Yeah, that's good to know.
No, this is super useful. Now, you're a guy that likes the branding. So are Alec and I.
Yeah.
And you have to differentiate yourself. Where can people find you? We want to flood you with leads.
Yeah, yeah. No,
we want to make make you the most popular real estate guy in the city, which I'm sure you will be already. And let me just say, I'm not trying to sound like an old guy here, but I'm sat with two people who I have 10 years on, who've only been in their industries for under two years. Mm.
You can big dog us. Yeah, under 2 years.
2 years.
I'm not an old guy by any means. I'm very young, but I'm a little older than you guys. And this isn't condescending. This is me genuinely saying it is so great and refreshing to look at the pool of young professionals in this city and guys that clearly are legit, clearly have the goods and know what they're talking about. So I think that's great because when I started in this industry, I used to show up to things where my age worked against me.
Mm-hmm.
But the pedigree of young real estate professionals in this city is mind-blowing. So
I haven't really
good on you guys.
I'm trying to think of age is never. It's kind of cool. I think when I first started, I had people. I didn't know what to do. I was like, oh, where do I start? How do I do it? Some people said, you know, tell them you're new to the industry. Tell them you're new and you have
fake it till you make it.
But they said, tell them you have lots of time on your hands because you're new and you're young. And I was like, part of me was like, I don't think I should tell people that. I said I should just go do business as if I've been doing this for years. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I've ever mentioned my, you know, how long I've been doing. If someone asks, yes, but I don't bring it up or I don't say I'm super young.
Yeah, I wouldn't bring it up.
I just don't bring it up. If someone asks, I'm like, yeah, I've been doing it this. And then usually it's like, oh, really? Like if you're doing a good job, that's when you hope you do a really good job. They're like, how long have you been doing this? You're like, well, actually under 2 years. And they're like, damn, if you're doing a good job. So I never say anything about that. I just let it roll. And it's funny. As long as you do a good job, you very rarely get questioned.
Well, and that's why I think it's so important to, you know, I know some do and some don't, but get those testimonials.
Yeah.
Get those, you know, again, I'm sure it's a little different in commercial, but with residential, get proof that you did a good job. Because even if people don't say it, they look at you and they're oh, he's young.
Yeah.
You know, what does he know? Right? And stuff like that. And I think it's just so important to, with every deal, doesn't matter, do a great job.
Mm-hmm.
That way, when your referrals come in, they already, again, there's that trust, but there's that, you got the referral for a reason.
Yeah.
They're not going to care about your age. They're going to be like, oh, he did such an amazing job. I don't care. He's 25.
Yeah.
You know, and you know what? I think with young agents too, like ourselves and other young agents, you know, it's
not you, James. Sorry.
Yeah, yeah.
Screw you.
Yeah.
You had a little silence there. He was like, oh.
He didn't know what to say.
All I will say is I haven't hit 40 yet.
No,
I'm not far away. But
I'm 15 years from 40.
Yeah.
But I think it's just people see through it. So long as you stay true to yourself, mm-hmm. and do a good job, people will see that.
So the branding you have, Redhead Realtor. You're on Instagram, you're on LinkedIn, you're on all the platforms.
Everything.
Plug yourself. Go for it. We're going to open the mics. You can do whatever you want. No. It's $20 a minute.
How do you find the reception of that is the Redhead Realtor, that just overall
It's funny because, you know, when I call other agents on deals or whatnot, I say, hey, it's John Lander with Remax. Trying to be a little bit professional with that first and last name. Oh, okay, yeah, awesome. I didn't know you were like... Oh, have you ever heard of the Redhead Realtor? Oh, my God. Yeah, yeah. I say, well, hi. And they're like, no. And I'm like,
oh. I saw you drive a Bronco?
Yeah.
I saw it whipping around down Spring Garden. Yeah. Redhead Realtor on the side.
Yeah.
Have you branded the car?
Yeah. Subtle. It's subtle. But it's there with a little flame. Yeah.
I branded mine as well. It says Acura on it.
Yeah. I don't know. When I started the brand, I said, if you're not going 100%, someone else is, and your brand will suck.
Mm-hmm.
This whole podcast exists. I'm going to tell a little secret on air now. There's many secrets I can't tell people. This podcast exists purely because we figured a competitor would do something at some point.
Yeah. We want to be the first American 100%.
And I call it sticking the American flag in the moon. You haven't got to do it perfectly. It's like the old MVP of the tech world, the minimum viable product. You just create it, ship it, and then whoever does it after you, well, they look like they've come.
Well, and that's exactly it, right? I think, you know, especially the reason I came up with this brand, well, truth be told, It was a late night.
You even dyed your hair for it, too.
No, but my partner's father and I, we were having a couple pops one night.
Oh, okay.
And, you know, very fortunately, kind of with what you said about who you take your advice from, you know, he owned an insurance company up in New Brunswick with his brother or whatnot. So good advice, right? Great business mm-hmm. advice. And he said, you know, in an oversaturated job field, which it is, there's a lot of realtors.
Mm-hmm. Barrier to entry is low, right? Yeah. I mean, for us
yes.
too.
Yes.
I always say the barrier to entry is a brain cell and a real estate license.
Yeah. So he said, if you're going to do this, do something different. Do something unique mm-hmm. because you need to stand out. I always say to people, I need to be a different fish in the pond, right?
Yeah.
So it's weird. But if you go to a pet store, you see 100 goldfish. Why are you picking one of them, mm-hmm. right? You got to just do something different.
Yeah.
So anyway, we know came up with this, and I always reference the movie. You ever watch Focus with Will Smith? I told you about this.
Yeah,
you told me this story.
Yeah.
I do not watch movies, unfortunately.
Well, you're too busy working.
He's busy.
That's what happens when you get close to 40.
I can't focus, and I have very little imagination.
That's okay.
Yeah, that's funny. But yeah, so the Will Smith movie. They're up in a skybox and they're hustling. That's what it's called.
Slapping Chris Rock.
Yeah. But anyway, yeah. So he said, pick a number on the football field and I'll guess it. So he's scanning the field and he picks a number. And he goes 55. And he's like, how the hell did you do that? Right? Football, there's a lot of people. So he said, that whole day I had that number implemented everywhere around you. Suite 55, taxi 55. Your bill was $55.55. Obviously, it's a movie. So, mm-hmm. But I just said to myself, I said, how am I going to do that with my local real estate market? So when I came up with that brand, I said, I need to throw that brand everywhere. The color red, the brand name, and that flame emoji just everywhere. That way, when someone's like, oh, I want to buy a house, they don't even think about it. They subconsciously think realtor, and then they put redhead in front of it.
Yeah.
So that's the approach.
And the alliteration, I mean, everything about the brand works, in my opinion.
Yeah.
I've got a marketing background, and your brand just makes logical sense. And I would, having looked at your branding, have said you spent a lot of money working with a branding company. But if you've done that yourself, then kudos.
Fortunately, kudos. So there's a lot of moments where, you know, my poor girlfriend's like, should I post this? What do you think of this? Like, but... Yeah, no, I just, you know what? I think it's working in a sense because I just have fun with it, mm-hmm. right?
Well, the other thing you should do, you should consider going on a podcast sometime.
Yeah.
A lot of fun.
I know this guy, Alec, who does one. He's shifty.
Yeah. Hey, easy.
Well, this has been a pleasure. Yeah. I think we have, Alec and I exist in the world of real estate, and we talk about existing in the world of real estate, but the commercial side is quite tight and quite small and quite narrow. Mm-hmm. Everybody always asks us about the residential world, and I have to say, I don't really know because I do, but I don't want to profess as being an expert because I don't live in that world. So this has been very helpful.
Yeah.
Where can people find you?
Instagram, it's jonathanlander.redheadrealtor. Any sort of social media, my number, Google John.
You can give us your number.
Yeah, 902.
All the ladies are going to text you.
220-6078.
I like the way you said that. That was good.
Literally, if you go on any social media and you type in Redhead Realtor, I should pop up. If I don't, I got work to do.
Yeah.
So,
Well, thank you for taking the time.
Awesome. I appreciate you guys having me out.
Yeah, we'll definitely get you on again. This was a lot of fun. And cheers, boys.
Cheers, everyone. Let's have an audible clink.
Audible clink.
That
was tough. All right. Thanks for coming on, Jonathan, and best of luck in this market.
Thanks.
Well, that was a great interview, James.
It went very quickly, didn't it?
It was very good. It was a quick interview. It was very good. A lot of good insight there and just an overall good guy to chat with. Interesting to hear about the brand and kind of how things are going right now. And once again, Jonathan Lander, Redhead Realtor for all your residential real estate needs. Not commercial, though. Call me and James.
Yes, please do not call him for commercial
stuff. Please call
us.
Please. Please call
us.
Please. All right. Next up, I'm going to get James, you to introduce this one, the new kids on the block, because you know them. And I'll let you do this one. So new kids on the block coming at you. Step
by step. Ooh, baby. Talking of boy bands.
Do you care? Step by step.
I want to clarify for everybody listening that all of the high-pitched stuff you're hearing is Alec every time. I can do it.
Not that tune that we're listening to. It's me.
You've got a good voice.
Really?
Can you sing?
Somewhere over the rainbow.
A little bit of
That's how you find out how much your steak and kidney pie weighs.
Ah.
Somewhere over the rainbow, weigh a pie.
Weigh a pie. I like that. I like that.
Weigh the pie, right?
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
You know what he's saying in a Middle Eastern accent? Actually, just so people are, Alec, we were doing accents in the office a couple of months ago.
Yeah.
Did you try to do Scottish and we said it was...
Jamaican.
Jamaican, was the one. Do your Scottish accent.
I do a Scottish accent and I cannot do a Scottish accent.
Everyone can do South African. As a Brit, South African is very easy accent to do.
Oh, I can do like Wakandan. I can't do South African. I can do like a Wakanda accent. You ever see Black Panther?
Let's do it.
This is the Matter Of Fax podcast. We are in Halifax, Nova Scotia, not Wakanda anymore.
That's good.
Yeah, it's not bad. I'm just a big Marvel fan, right? So,
can you do a Nova Scotia accent?
You know what? I can't because I just like that's just me talking, right?
It's like the whole contents of my voicemail. Here, bud, did you try and pass this building here?
This is James Collins. You missed me. I'm a real estate person. If you need something to help with real estate, give me a call back. I'm sure I can help you out with something like that. But, industrial's my thing. But, you know, call me for anything.
That sounds like the South Park character they never cast.
No. That actually sounds like... Never mind.
I like it. We're talking new kids. Oh, we're not talking a new kid on the block this time. We're talking a kid celebrating its 10th birthday. But with Jonathan Lander there, we opened up some North Brewing brews. And we are talking this month about North Brewing. It's finally opened up its tap room and kitchen at 501 Timberlea Village Parkway. Now, I know these guys very well. I've known them for quite a few years. They're absolutely wonderful. And they have been operating a retail store out of the new Timberlea location since, I believe, about a year ago. They've been slowly building out the tap room, and that is now open. Nice. And you can expect 60 seats. You'll only want to sit in one of them at a time. They're not all full, not musical chairs here. And this is what I love. They're serving tavern-style food with an Indian twist.
Oh, really? Oh, very cool. I've actually, I've never been to... there's one in Cole Harbour.
So there's Battery Park in Dartmouth, which they co-founded.
Right.
And then their headquarters used to be on Agricola Street. They had this amazing real estate guy, James Collins, this British guy, helped them move to Cole Harbour.
Never heard of him. No one's heard of him.
Then did the Timberlea deal. No, but seriously, their headquarters is Portland Street, I think 899 Portland Street, and Battery Park in Dartmouth, near 2 if by C there, is the Battery Park.
Yeah.
You've probably been there.
I haven't been inside. This is a delicious beer, by the way. I had the Alternate Reality New England IPA.
I had the Pleasant Disposition. Delicious. Yeah,
that was delicious. I was very good. I love any local craft beer like that, and these guys seem great. I don't know what this James Collins shifty guy they work with, but other than that, I think it's great. I'm really happy to hear they're out in Timberlea. I think they'll do well out there. It's just always nice to see a local brewery kind of expanding, right? You see it all the time. It's just one location sometimes, or just one small little tap room. But to get to their point where now they're having multiple locations, I'd like to go check that one out. I haven't gone to North Brewing before, I'll be honest. I haven't, and it's in Cole Harbour. My girlfriend's family's over in Cole Harbour. I think they've probably gone. I've never been in there, but I'd love to go. We should go to the Timberlea one.
We should talk a lot right now. No, but let me tell you why these guys are great, and I'm passionate about this.
Yeah.
I work with North Brewing very closely, and every single decision these guys make with their locations is based on how can we contribute to the community.
Right.
So they were an amazing client to work with, because when you work with folks trying to find commercial space, they have different motivations and different reasons that they're looking for a location or a certain type of building. But every conversation with North Brewing was, we want to embed ourselves in the community. We want to become a non-downtown community hub, but we want to give and serve the community in the right way. And it was very refreshing for me to work with someone that thought that way. So an amazing group of people. And they have also not just got multiple locations and multiple beers, but they have continued expanding their repertoire. So they now have alcoholic seltzer. Never say that word.
Seltzer.
Alcoholic seltzer.
Yeah, you got it.
It's my British accent.
Yeah, seltzer.
Blue nose. Iced tea and cider. They also have their own vodka as well.
Oh, nice.
So talk about
really
diversity.
Expanding. I like that. Because I love beer as much as the next beer lover. I can only have a few before I start to feel a little bloated. I got to switch to vodka, switch to a seltzer or something like that. So I'm really glad to hear that they're having multiple options in that realm. But no, that's very cool.
Yeah, and the beer is delicious. The locations are super, super.
Who found the location?
Super trendy. This British guy.
Yeah, it's British.
Yeah, but all you need to know is it's 501 Timberlea Village.
That's all I need. That's all I need.
And you should head there because you can now get an amazing range of drinks and food and just the best people and the most down-to-earth guys. And happy birthday to them celebrating 10 years.
Happy birthday. Wow.
You ready, Alec? One, two, three.
Happy birthday to you.
This was not planned.
Happy birthday to you.
Go high.
Happy birthday, dear North Brewing. Happy birthday to you.
Great.
Very good.
Oh, God, I'm out of breath now.
Yeah, I know. I got a little lightheaded from that one. You know what? That reminds me of a scene from The Office.
Michael always does really, the high harmony.
Happy birthday.
I forget which birthday it was, but...
That was the episode with Meredith and Creed when they can't decide if they're having the peach cobbler or the...
Oh, that's one where Jim tries to combine...
Please everyone by combining birthdays.
Yes, and then Michael comes back because he was doing his wilderness thing.
That was it.
Yeah. That's a good one. I like that.
I haven't eaten for at least... 3 hours.
At least I'm going to fancy this pant leg into a headband, which I can use for later.
Then he realizes he needs it again. Anyway, happy birthday, yeah, North Brewing. Congrats guys on the new location. And you have fueled this podcast, and it's been delicious.
Yeah, won't be the last time we enjoy one of your cold ones on one of our podcasts. All right, up next, we have our final segment of the episode, the Reddit Roundup.
Reddit Roundup.
Losing their minds over minor inconveniences.
This one is for every Scrooge and bah humbug in the city.
Bah humbug.
I can't stand Christmas, the over-commercialization of the birthday of Jesus.
Well, Christmas. Christmas is nothing to me.
it's nothing compared to my birthday.
You ever see the Christmas Carol? Is it called A Christmas Carol? The one in the Neptune where it's a one-man show? You ever watch that? He plays Ebenezer Scrooge and he plays the ghost of Christmas Past. He plays everybody in the thing.
Really? No, yeah, I know the story very well. But.
Yeah, but there's this one guy, and Jenna, I'm sorry. I'm going to call you out here. She really doesn't like it. She thinks it's hilariously dumb. I think it's amazing. I think it's really cool how one guy every year puts on a one-man show. It takes a lot of balls, if you ask me. I love it. I think it's really awesome. I recommend going, honestly. And then this year, Elf as well, but... That's Ebenezer Scrooge, the one-man show Christmas Carol. He's very good.
Well, that's an interesting... I last went to the Neptune, and I should know the name of the show. I'll be honest, I got free tickets, but they had three characters played 120 characters, or three people played 120 characters.
That's pretty cool.
Over the 2 hours.
As someone with film and TV background, I find that very cool and interesting.
Oh, you would have... You would have liked it. It was intense and it was very well done. And I actually went and I was thinking, how can these guys play 40 characters each and make it convincing? But yeah, it was very well done.
Very cool. Before I get into my Reddit post that I made, the whole namesake, Haligonians losing their minds. I actually saw a post on Reddit about where the name Haligonians comes from.
From Halifax, I think.
Yes and no. But like, yes and no. No and yes. But I don't know if it's true or not. So here's what this guy said. His name was Biscuit Lips.
His birth name.
Yes. That's a great name. I'm going to put it in the back pocket. We're all called Haligonians due to an error derived from the mistaken Latin translation of Halig Fax, F-A-E-X, which means holy hair, instead of Halifax, which roughly means secluded spot with rough grass. They took Halig and slapped a Latin suffix on that shit, and that's why we're Haligonians. Someone goes, don't know if that's right, but I hope it is. So to be correct, we're supposed to be Halihonians. And then someone goes, Hal if I know, heh. I hereby move that we shall henceforth be known as Halihonians. Halihonians.
Halihooligans.
Halihooligans. I like that. Anyway, just a small little thing.
That's a history lesson.
Yeah, not bad. Enough. Did you get a chance to look at that Reddit post I made?
Yeah, I did. So we planted on Reddit this month. I think Alex should read out verbatim his original post. Yes. I have a...
you have a write-out of it for me?
Well, I didn't handwrite it, but I did print it.
Okay, so my post actually stemmed... So first of all, my name is Crafty Steak 1766 on Reddit, if you want to look me up. My post stemmed from I went to Bears Lake this past weekend with Jenna, my girlfriend, and I don't think I'll go back there for 2022, maybe 2023. So my question was, wildest Bears Lake Christmas shopping experience? And my little note was, we all know Bears Lake turns into a place less desirable than the running of the bulls in Spain, but we all seem to keep going there during the holiday season. So I want to know your craziest story slash experience. Maybe it was at a store in the parking lot, and I'm sure there's many of those stories, in a restaurant, Costco, or wherever. So let's hear how wild it got for some people.
Well, I'm dumb because I went and printed this off. And I actually, for some reason, I printed off 7 copies of the same page. So I actually do not have this Reddit thread in front of me.
No.
So using the magic of audio editing, I'm now going to pause this while I go and find it, and we will be back.
Yeah. I have one here I read that was, it's not controversial, just crazy. Someone said their name was Huron Neuron. A few years ago, it took me 3 hours to leave the parking lot of Canadian Tire. People were abandoning their cars and busing home.
Wow.
Imagine having to be that desperate, like 3 hours to leave the Canadian Tire parking lot and you resort to just leaving your car, come back and get all bus home. Screw it.
They should start charging by the hour for parking. Imagine how much money they would make when everyone abandoned their cars.
Imagine how many tickets, though, people would just park and try and get away with it. And
you call Halifax, the municipality, they'll tell you how to overcharge for parking.
Hey, ba-dooms. No, yeah, that was the one that I saw first, which I thought was that was kind of crazy. What are you got any there you see?
This one is wild. It says it's from human 83973839. It says, this one time I almost went to Bears Lake at Christmas, but instead went to Izzy's Bagels and ate it in the car on the way to Dartmouth Crossing. Wild day.
Human now, had the right idea.
You have to, I think one of us needs to read or at least a synopsis of Black Coffee Red Wine's post, because it's a very long post. But it genuinely is hilarious. Do you want to read it?
It's great. It's I'll do a little Sparks note on it, like a little quick. I can scan pretty well.
I'm not good at that stuff.
Pretty
you
read.
Want to do it?
So, Black Coffee Red Wine said he's a Sac Vegas exile. Also, it says he or she. So he came back from his shift to find that FedEx delivered a board game he ordered from Amazon to Kent.
How did that happen?
I don't know how that happens. Delivered to Kent in Bears Lake. On the way, it began to pour, like just pour rain, and he only had a hoodie on. He got into Kent, and he got a few things while he was there anyway. So essentially with Black Coffee, Red Wine, essentially he went to Kent to get that package that Amazon for some reason delivered to Kent. He bought a bunch of things while he was there, went to the cash register, boom. He actually spelled it boom. Metal hull of the place clanged like a bell. Thunder. So the boys were joking. Ha, ha, ha. And then boom, snow. And then boom, more thunder. He was like, what the hell? So he's like, okay, I'm cabin home at this point. So now it's a full-on blizzard outside. So he's a full-on blizzard. Thunderstorm blizzard has occurred outside while he's been inside buying extra. He bought some succulents and a plunger and stuff and all that crap.
Hopefully not to use together.
You never know. Hey, don't judge.
I'm going to shove this down the toilet.
Don't judge a man. And yes, he was going to pay, and boom, power goes out in the whole store. And it was while he was paying. So, and the cashier had no way to confirm if his $200 bill. Yeah, $200 bill. No way to confirm if it went through. So he. He took the stuff anyway, as if to know it went through, and like assumed it went through. And then the cashier said, wow, what a great deal on those succulents. And he was like, okay, thank you. And then left. He got a cab home. In the cab ride, he says that the weather was perfectly fine. The plows had cleared and it was like Bears Lake was on a different planet. And which I'm like, dude, how much time did you spend in Kent? You got to Kent, there was no snowstorm. And by the time you left Kent, one had happened and it was now roads were clear. We all know how long it takes to clear the roads around here. I don't know how true that story is. Anyways, a few days later, he noticed his credit card bill was double billed. So he was charged twice for it.
Oh, be an Eastlink customer. You'll get double charge every month. And then they'll say, it could take 45 to 60 days to reverse the charge.
I am an Eastlink customer. I don't check enough.
You don't pay your bill? They always say, if you think nobody cares about you, stop paying your bills. Then everyone sends you letters.
Jeez, I got to look into that.
So, where are we going here with Black Coffee, Red Wine?
You know what? Essentially, he... I think the craziest part's the start. The Amazon package got delivered to Kent. I think sounds like he lived nearby because he walked there and then in a hoodie. And then it started pouring as he was walking. Went in, did his thing, decided, oh, I'm just going to buy a bunch of other shit.
It's raining. It's pouring. The Amazon delivery guy is snoring.
I like that.
You like that? It was quick.
That was good. You thought it off the cuff. That was really good.
I did.
That's impressive. So he's in there, and he has a bunch of crap, and Thunder. I mean, I think he over-exaggerates a little bit. I mean, Thunder and rain is what it is.
I would say black but coffee, red wine is an exaggeration.
But I'd say the power going out mid-transaction is kind of funny. Like, that doesn't happen too often. Enough to know the cashier is like, I don't know. I don't know if it went through, but take your stuff and figure it out.
The Irving family, thank you for the double payment.
Ah, very good. And it was so double payment. I don't know if he ever got it sorted out. He never really said anything about he tried to call the accountant and he rectified it after Christmas. Tried to joke with Jenna, you're gonna hate this one, but I gotta say it. Tried to joke with her about the experience I had in Bear's Lake, but you know, .. accountants.
Oh yeah.
Boom, that's a burn.
It's actually Jenna CPA.
Jenna McClellan CPA, yes.
You can't say Jenna.
I can't even, when I address her, I have to say CPA. Like, if I don't, that's disrespectful, right? I'm mean, just, you know. So that's the story from Black, what's his name? Black Coffee, Red Wine. That sounds like a good Saturday night.
I mean, it could have been said in fewer words, but it was overall quite entertaining.
Took a long time. Do you read any other ones you got there? No, your phone looks like it's...
I'm good. You know, after my little printing error here. Then there were some other funny ones. Somebody said, one time I drove in, got what I needed, and left in the span of 10 minutes.
Rare. Very rare.
I was in Bears Lake a few months ago, and there was a clear, what do they call them, crash for cash scam going on. Do you know what the crash for cash thing is? It's when somebody rearranges you or jumps in front of your car.
Oh, I've seen videos of that.
In order to get the insurance claim,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
be like me. I have a dash cam on the front and back of a car, so you will not succeed.
Yeah.
You will not succeed with me, Alec, next time you try to jump in front of my car and sue me. But we were in Bears Lake. Anyway, this woman had like rear-ended or slammed the brakes on and they'd rear-ended her and they were fighting on the side of the road. So my wife and I go shopping and we come back about an hour and a half later and the woman is in a different place with the same thing happening.
Oh my God. Pathetic.
Yeah.
Come on.
And it's a real big problem in the UK where I came from. People literally throw themselves in front of cars and get injuries in order to sue off the insurance policy.
I see videos where people will fake the injury and everything. And then the guy or girl who hits them will go, there's literally a CCTV right there. You know you got caught. And then they get up and walk away.
And they walk away.
They know you got caught.
The key to it all is to buy a dash cam.
Yeah. You got a dash cam, yeah?
Two dash cams. I have one in the front and I have one in the rear.
And
I mean the dash cam.
You usually always have one in the front and the rear. The rear. Hotspot parking, 15 minutes left.
We better wrap this podcast up so you don't get...
I have to go to a team thing for hockey too. One thing I did read, someone walked from Bears Lake with a 65-inch TV and used the TV as a box as shelter from the wind and the snow on the walk.
That's subtle
flex that you bought a 65-inch TV.
Stolen.
Someone just a little kick to the knees and grab the TV and go. That wouldn't be too hard. I don't have experience with that. I'm just saying it wouldn't be too hard to do.
Yeah, Alec, because he perfectly talks about the hypothetical way a TV could be stolen and reminds us he's never done it.
You need four people. You need all this stuff.
And the best route from Bayers Lake is...
Yeah, here's how you want to exit. There's a trail in the back. You want to go that way. You're gonna want a sled, too, if you can, and some snowshoes. No, we went... You know, Bears Lake's crazy. In summary, Bears Lake is nuts. And... Christmas time in general brings out the worst of the worst in terms of drivers. Those who don't drive all year that have to drive at Christmas time, that's when they come out, is at Christmas time. And they go to Bears Lake. We went to Bears Lake the other day, and we knew it was going to be busy, but we went to Costco, which I'm not a huge fan of going to Costco. I love the deals. I just don't like going in. Jenna loves it. I wish I didn't have to go as well, but I do.
Can you still eat your way around? Because years ago, there used to be free samples everywhere.
There is, but it's always weird. There was free samples of hand cream.
Come and have us. Come and have us sneezed on cheese slices.
Literally.
And that kind of thing.
They had hand cream the other day as a free sample. I'm like, come on. Where's the what do you call them? The little glizzies, little hot dogs rolled up.
I want the pizza roll-ups.
New York accent going on here. But we went to Bears Lake. And at one point, I got into like a full-on Western standoff with three other cart drivers in the clothing section, because Jenna's like, oh, hold the cart while I go look at clothes. I'm like, oh, great. This is going to be fun. And I'm standing there, one person there, one person there, one person there, like an intersection, and no one wanted to move.
This aisle ain't big enough for the three of us.
Exactly. Four of us, technically. And I was like, I don't want to be here. I'm like, this is terrible. And then so we had two things in our cart. We had a robe and batteries, and we were driving along in the cart.
What were you up to?
Hey, it was, anyways, robe and the batteries and some and a big plush of Yoda. Anyway, so we were both.
Oh, now it makes sense.
Now it's all coming together.
Now you have put the panda ties
now
together.
Now it's coming together. And then Jenna looks at me and she goes, I'm about to do something I've never done, and I hope you never forget it. And she just launches the cart down a random aisle and says, we're leaving. And I was like, no way. She's like, this is insane. Because the line, like, wrapped all the way down, wrapped around the meat. It wrapped all the way.
We should have done that as insane as the crane.
Yeah, that was definitely an insane.
We heard about this CPA that launched a rogue shopping cart.
She's in danger of losing her CPA license for launching the rogue shopping cart.
Article 14.1 is that licensees will remain responsible with shopping carts.
Once you enter Costco, you must exit with your items and pay. No, it was great. We left, but then we went right to Dartmouth Crossing, and I mean, it was busy, but it was doable. It was fine. Went to multiple stores. We didn't go to Costco there. We didn't bother dealing with that beast again. But even like that person said, they went to Izzy's Bagels and then to Dartmouth Crossing and got their stuff and was done. Wild day. And Dartmouth Crossing, I think, is just better for that. I think
I just don't like retailing. I don't like our retail developments in HRM.
No. And then Bears Lake is just, oh, it's not fun. And I won't go back there. You know, I do some work out in that area, but that's during the work day. It's not as crazy out there. During that time. Yeah, that was my Reddit roundup. I wish I posted that, I think, yesterday or the day before, so I didn't get as much action as I wanted to. I wish I would have got more action, but it's the way it is.
Maybe you'll get some more action next month. Talking of next month, we will be bringing everybody into the studio, as we mentioned.
Yeah.
I'm going to be bringing some games.
Oh.
I have a surprise for Alec and everyone coming that you will potentially like.
Really? I have a surprise, too.
I'm not buying you. Just to set this up, I'm not buying you anything. I'm not giving you a gift.
You're going to buy me anything. Give me
but
a gift.
But I have something for you.
That's okay. I'm always happy when you have something for me.
Oh, I have something for you.
You got something for me.
I got something for you, Alec.
I'll take it. Yeah, no, I have a little surprise, too.
Just bring the Yoda.
I will bring the Yoda. I have a little surprise, too. Only thing is, it might not be ready by December 1st, which is hopefully when we're going to film. It's okay if it isn't. We'll do it another time. But anyways, I'm looking forward to that episode. Bringing the wife slash, what, Jenna would be common law partner is what I could call her.
Before I was married, because I had to make a residency application to Canada, I designated Jen as my common law spouse because mm-hmm. we met the definition.
Yeah, we do too. Yeah.
That's right.
That'll be a fun one. We'll go somewhere before. We'll come in here. Get a good episode going. We got our redhead realtor hats on right now.
We've got our baseball caps, thanks to Mr. Landers. He was a great guest, yeah. And I think this was a good episode.
This is a good episode.
We've kept it a little, I think, maybe a little calmer than usual. I don't know. We'll listen to the edit.
Yeah, we'll see what happens, and we'll see what Bill thinks.
And this is the issue with this, is sometimes I come away from the studio and I think, wow, that was quite a sensible episode. Then I listen to what we actually said, and then sometimes I leave and I'm driving back and I think, oh, you know, we can get rid of that in the edit, but I shouldn't have said that. Maybe I offended someone, and it's fine.
It's fine. You know what's funny? Sometimes I don't even listen to the edit sometimes. I'll be totally honest. I let you listen to it and Bill for anything like bad to come open. I'm like, you know what? I said what I said. And if Cushman and Wakefield is okay with it being in there, I'm okay with what I've said. Like, you know what I mean? So, and I don't like listening to myself a ton either. It's just why, like, sometimes I don't even listen to the podcast when it finally goes out. I listen to like certain parts of it, not my voice. Because I find like listening.
You've got a nice voice.
Really?
Yeah. I listen just to your voice.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
That's all I do.
You just cut. You ask for an edit from BNV of
I do,
just
I say,
my voice.
Can you send me the cranny cut?
The cranny cut. And it's just me the whole time. That. And my like my weird noises. Yeah,
yeah, exactly. Can you send me the cranny cut and a box of Kleenex?
Hang on. Right.
Yeah, that's just the emotions are just crying.
No, I know. Yeah. Crying, tear. I'm not going to go any further. There. Episode 8. That was great. Very good. Some good Insane as a Crane topic. Nice to hear about a business that's expanding. It's always great to hear in the city and someone you know. Reddit Roundup. That was decent. And Mr. Lander, that was incredible. Great guest. Redhead Realtor. We got some cool hats out of it.
I like these.
I like those. Like the city line there. It's actually Halifax. Like
it
you
is
can see
Halifax.
The Purdy's Towers there. That's very cool.
I think if you go on Instagram for this podcast or BNV Media, what is our I don't use Instagram anymore. What's our Instagram handle?
It's just Matter Of Fax podcast.
Okay, you can see Dylan the redhead realtor caps. I think Alec and I need to get some.
Yeah, we'll figure something out. But these are pretty well done. Anyways, thank you everybody for tuning in to episode 8 of the Matter Of Fax podcast.
Tuning in. You notice no one's tuned into anything on a radio for about 50 years.
No one's tuned in.
Well, they click it, don't they?
Yeah.
Remember when they used to say, oh, you'd listen to all the old radio things and they go, don't adjust your dial. We'll be right back. When I was a kid, my parents used to have a radio and you would literally turn the dial and you'd have the station and then you'd have all that white noise in the middle. So it would be like, and the beautiful red roses of the English country. You know, you just go between the stations with the white noise. So why do we say tune in?
I don't know.
But thanks for tuning in.
Yeah, thanks for tuning in. Thanks for listening, guys, guys and gals. We are looking forward to our next episode, which we are actually filming not too long from now. Usually it's a bit of a bigger gap, but we got to get it in with the Christmas season coming up. Yeah, during the Christmas season, you know, it's got to go in. All right, looking forward to it. Next episode, tune in. Thanks again to all of our listeners, downloaders. If you have any comments or suggestions, what is it? Halifaxpodcast@gmail.com.
Yes.
Ba-dooms.
We have had 2 emails to date. So
was it my uncle and your brother?
Oh, one email. Sorry, one email. Two reviews and one email.
Ah, yes. But he wants to come on, by the way, my uncle. He's going to fly in just to be on the episode, he said.
Yeah, we'll do it.
Yeah. So we'll get him in at some point in the new year. He said,
tell him to give us his receipts for his flight in his hotel, and we won't pay them.
We're just going to rip them up. Just so he doesn't have to look at them. Very good. Thanks again, everybody, and we'll see you next month.